Good evening, everyone. Thanks for joining us for this session. I would like to give a warm welcome to our panelists, Lalit, Rakshit, and Jinesh. Thank you so much for giving time to us on a Saturday. That too, thank you so much. I'm sure our students and inquiries will gain a lot by listening to you and taking tips from you. So thank you very much for joining us. So I noticed that a lot of you are not Jamboree students. So I'll begin by giving a brief introduction about Jamboree. So Jamboree is an organization that trains students on exams such as GRE, GMAT, IELTS, TOEFL, and helps students apply to universities which accept these courses. So if there is any university that accepts any of these courses, you know, then we help students apply to those universities. We have been doing this since 1993. So we are the oldest institute of its kind in India. We have 39 physical centers in 22 cities across 4 countries. We also have been training students online, you know, since 2012. In fact, since majority of last year, so since March of 2020, we have been teaching online. And that has been actually working out quite well for us because we already had the infrastructure and the faculty were trained on it, right? And these exams, GMAT, GRE, and TOEFL, these are exams that you can take from your home also. So you do not have to go out to a physical test center. Okay, so students have been actually taking advantage of the lockdown, preparing for these exams online with us and taking these exams, you know, from the familiarity of their homes. So this has actually, a lot of students have actually taken you know, advantage of the lockdown in that sense, right? So if any of you would want to take a demo class with Jamboree, or if you want to do a profile evaluation session, you can leave your numbers in the chat. Your messages are coming only to us, right? So you don't have to worry about other people getting access to your numbers. So anybody, if you want a demo class, either a GRE demo class, GMAT demo class, or a profile evaluation session about what kind of colleges you can get into, what are the scores required for the colleges that you have in mind, any such queries, any one-on-one counseling session, just leave your number in the chat. So, so today, as I said, we have some of our students. So Lalit, he has gotten admission in UCLA. He will be joining UCLA for this session. Rakshit has gotten admission in University of Maryland, and Jinesh has got admission in Northeastern University. So I would request them to, you know, give their introductions and speak in detail. So Lalit, can you switch on your video and audio?
Yes.
Yes, hi Lalit. So can you tell our audience a little about yourself, as in when will you be starting your program, and which program did you apply for, where have you gotten admission, what is your GRE score, etc.?
So my name is Lalit Bhagat, and recently I completed my Bachelor of Technology in Computer Science and Engineering from JP Institute of Information Technology. And now for fall 2021, I'll be joining University of California, Los Angeles for the MS in Computer Science program. So I started my journey in second year of my college. I started preparing for GRE in the second year, and I also started doing my research work from third year. I started writing research papers and building my profile. So it took me around 1 to 2 years to build my profile and get into UCLA. So
congratulations.
Thank you.
So Rakshit, can I ask you to give your introduction in similar format?
First of all, hi everyone. I'm Rakshit Sinha. I'm an incoming MSIS student at the University of Maryland College. So my journey from if you talk about GRE and all started somewhere around 2017, early 2017. Okay, and I took a few test series and I got I accumulated information about it. At the same time, I also started researching about which field I should go in, and ultimately I filtered out that information systems is the field in which I should pursue my master's in. Apart from that,
Rakshit, I think you are on mute. Not able to hear you, Rakshit. Your audio seems to have gone off. I think Rakshit is facing technical difficulties maybe. So we'll go on to Jinesh. Jinesh, can you switch on your video and give your introduction to our audience?
Sure. Hi, everyone. My name is Jinesh Mehta, and I got an admit into Northeastern University for Master's in Computer Science program. And I'll be going to Boston to pursue that in this fall 2021. And I recently got my visa approved. I have been working in Honeywell. So I got graduated in 2017 with a computer and communication degree from Manipal Institute of Technology in Manipal. And I was working with Honeywell for the past 4 years. And now I have got an admit into Northeastern University, and I'm trying to pursue that, my master's into that particular program. And also my GRE, I gave my GRE in October 2020 and I got a score of 316, and probably I submitted all my applications by the end of December, and I got an admit in the first month of this year. So that is January 2021. Yep, I think that is a short introduction about me.
So Jinesh, so when did you start your GRE preparation, and how much time did it take you? And also, can you give us the split of your 316?
Yeah, so I'll start with my split first. So I got a split of 164 and 152. So I started my preparations back in January 2020, I think. So I did my the 10 sessions, the learning sessions, the initial 10 sessions with Jamboree, 10 to 12 sessions of learning, which they provide in the first 2 months. So I was done with all my learning sessions in March, I think around 22nd of March. So that is when I started, you know, preparation for my Jamboree. And unfortunately, the COVID situation happened, and because of the pause in the middle, I was not able to prepare for the next 3 or 4 months because I had to travel back home for some personal reasons. And then I started again my preparation. So basically all the learning part for me was completed by Jamboree, like the initial phase. Like, you know, you can see the first part of the GRE exam, the learning phase was done in person, and then the practice sections and everything is what I pursued online. You know, all the faculties and everyone helped me in solving all the doubts, and all the online session used to happen quite regularly. Probably you can, you know, they have to give their WhatsApp number, then you can call them for doubts and everything. So that happened along in the month of June, July, August, September. So I was giving my mock exams, getting my doubts resolved, and the iterations of all your tests and everything happened across in the later, like third quarter of the year in 2020. And that is when, like once I was confident enough, I had scheduled my exam for October, and I had given my exam in I think in mid-October for my GRE.
Right. So, Rakshit?
Yeah, hi, Aryama. So,
Your video is off, Rakshit.
Yeah.
So, Rakshit, I think you have applied for business analytics, right?
No, I have actually applied for information systems, and I got into University of Maryland, MSIS. Okay. Yeah. Right.
So you have how many years of work experience?
Currently, this August, I'll be having 3 years of work experience.
So usually students, they after getting 2-3 years of work experience, they prefer to go for the MBA program. So why did you, decide to do an MS instead?
See, information system is actually a hybrid between technicalities and managerial as well. So once you graduate in information systems, you'll have a very flexible option of, you know, going either towards management side or you're going towards technical side. For me, my technical side was personally quite strong, and I actually wanted to, you know, go for a higher ops for that. Like, I really wanted to delve deep into this technicality area, and especially in the field of data science and all. So I chose information systems. Initially, I was planning for business analytics, but you know, it focuses mostly on the technicality stuff and very little on the managerial stuff. But for me, information systems was actually a perfect blend for technical courses as well as managerial courses. So that's why I chose information systems over an MBA.
Lalit?
Yes.
So Lalit, you know, so we get students, you know, who express concerns that because of COVID, you know, they probably should not, you know, travel or they should not go to the US. So didn't you have any such concerns when you were applying last year in the middle of the first wave, probably you were applying. So didn't you face such any such concerns?
Yeah, it was a problem. Like many people were saying that you shouldn't apply, you shouldn't go, but like I had to go, and I wanted to pursue my research and education from US, and I expected that after a year that things would be fine, and now they are fine. So for fall 2021, they are opening in person. So everything is fine. And next year also, it would be fine for fall 2022.
That's what, you know. So Lalit, what is your GRE score? What is the split?
So I scored 166 in quant and 142 in verbal. So it was 308.
So see, there is also this misconception that to get into a top 10 college like UCLA, you must have 330, etc., etc. And so with 308, you got admission in UCLA, right? So what do you have to say to such people?
Yeah, so actually I didn't submitted my GRE score because it was waived off because of COVID. But if you don't submit your GRE score, you should like have a good GPA and good research work experience. So they look at your overall profile. Even people with 315 and 320 got into UCLA, they had a very good research experience. Like I had three publications, one in general, one in conference, and I also had a patent. And two of them were, I was the primary author. So this showed my capability to perform independent research. So that was the plus point that got me into UCLA.
Right. So that's what I wanted to point out to the attendees also, that there's just lots of misconceptions that you have to have 330 to apply to a top school. So it's not like India where, you know, you need only a good GATE score to get admission. So when you apply abroad, you know, they are going to look at your entire profile, your academics, your research profile, your GRE score, everything, right? And if you excel in a few of them, then you know, then a lower GRE score, even a lower academics will not be, you know, can be compensated. Another myth that I usually encounter, you know, students say, oh, I'm not from an IIT, so obviously I will not get admission in a good college. So again, you know, there is no guarantee that if you're from IIT, you will get admission, or if you're not from IIT, you will not get admission in a top college. It all boils down to the overall profile, right? So, and in Lalit's case, he started working on his profile from his second year of engineering, right? There are students who start in fourth year also, but you should know which activities to take up, right? So
even I'm not from IIT.
So. Yeah, I know you are not. So I just wanted to point out that because I get students who would say, I'm not from IIT, so I will definitely not get into a good course. So they write themselves off, you know, instead of taking a chance, you know, taking a shot, right? Rakshit, you know, when you were a working professional and you prepared for your exams your work, right? So you're juggling your GRE preparation with your work. So how did you do that?
Yeah, that's a very interesting question. So my office timing were 9 to 6, just like any other Indian IT guy. So after my work got over, from 8 o'clock, I sincerely studied like till 11, 12, okay? And every day I divided the things, like, you know, for like, not always in 50-50 ratio, but yeah, I always focused on which part of mine, like suppose if I'm preparing in quants, and let's say my probability is weak. Okay, so I always, you know, highlight all those things and, you know, give them the preference and try to solve all the doubts. Nowadays, we have really cheap internet. We can search a lot of things. We can search a lot of question papers, you know. We can find the quickest way of doing the same thing. So all these kind of things help me. And apart from that, on weekends also, I basically had to sacrifice a lot of my weekends. But, you know, I don't have any kind of guilt because I also prepared last year. And last year, since there was a lockdown, so it was a bit easy for me to prepare because all of us were at home, and you know, it's relatively easy for one to prepare at home along with the job. So, you know, and ultimately, you know, my GR score was okay. Like, it was good. That's fine.
Did you take the GRE exam from your home or from a test center?
No. At that time, I took my GRE on August 8th last year. Okay. And at that time, centers were opened.
Okay.
So yeah, I took it on a center.
How about you, Jinesh? How did you take your GRE exam?
No, I also had taken my. So I had taken my GRE exam in person, but I had taken the TOEFL one in home because I think by that time the city was in lockdown, so we were not allowed to go out.
So Jinesh, any advice? You know, now looking back, you have now the what you can say the advantage of hindsight, right? So, and we have students today who are just starting out with their GRE preparation, so to say. So, do you have any particular advice that you would like to give them, you know, for their GRE preparation?
Sure. So, I'll just, from my experience specifically, I think for everyone, it will be, you know, kind of different. But just to keep it everything on a generic level, as you know, we have, you know, quant and verbal, two sections probably mainly which you need to target based on your score. So for me, I had a good control or grip on the quant side, as I think most of our you know, folks have a good quant knowledge but struggle in the verbal side or the English side. So I was also in the same bucket, and when I started my preparations, so I think I used to search a lot online, and I think Jammari mentors also used to tell me that there's something called as error log. Okay, so that is, I think, a key thing which, you know, I would recommend everyone to follow up to, like, specifically if you're targeting, you know, good universities which demand a higher quant score, they ask you, like, so something like an error log is something which you may have to keep it from the starting, because you know, when you are between like 160 to 165 in your mock tests, probably when you are giving your section test, it is quite easy to increase the scores till like 160, 165. But once you reach a barrier of 165 in your quant, it becomes like actually very difficult to increase the score even by 1 point. So once you know your mistakes, so probably, after your 165, increasing the score is all about accuracy and getting the method correct, because after that you will basically struggle with your timing, or probably, you know, you'll try to avoid a lot of silly mistakes, and for that you will need to understand probably, you know, one of your concepts might be somewhat weak, or you might be taking a lot of time into solving a kind of a difficult problem. So that is where your error log specifically comes into picture. So for me, you know, once I keep a track of what all mistakes I used to do very frequently, I used to focus more on those particular topics, and I used to practice. So there are like two set of books which Chamori will give you. So you have a lot of practice questions with you, and they have a lot of questions. You know, a bucket of problems is like the pool is very big, so you can practice a lot of questions for every topic in there, and they have a lot of, you know, variety of questions as well. So you can practice a lot of difficult, easy, medium level questions, and once you solve them, you'll, you know, gradually reduce your errors, and you can see over time that you will, you know, be able to perform better in your quant side. And something with respect to verbal, I would say that, you know, try to do the list. So mainly, I think there are three sections. You know, you have sentence completion, you have equivalence, and you have reading comprehension. So Once you give your, you know, sample exams or your initial mock test where you say your diagnosis test, you'll be able to know where you struggle. So once you know where you're struggling, you know, you'll identify which all areas are your weak spot or your, you know, the thing which you need to work on. So for me, it was mostly with respect to reading comprehension. So I used to focus more towards text completion by, you know, increasing the accuracy of the amount of questions I get correct, because I know out of 20 questions, the 12 questions which I have a complete control over, I can easily score as much as I want to because I have good confidence in solving them. And it is relatively easy. Once you know the methods of, you know, how your Jamboree mentors tell you how you need to tackle the question, it is quite easy. But with respect to reading comprehension, it is comparatively challenging. But for me, once I got a good grip of the list of 14, you know, vocabulary list, this which Jamboree provides you when you're preparing your GRE exam, it helps you solve a lot of, you know, questions quite easily. So the confidence builds up, you know, gradually over the verbal side as well. So for me, I think that is how I had prepared in the span of, you know, initially for the first 2 months, the learning session, as well as for the practice sessions in the third or the fourth quarter of my GRE preparation.
So Rakshit, how about you? Any advice to students, you know, during their GRE preparation?
One of the most important thing which you need to keep is patience. Like initially, when you'll scrape through a lot of test papers, you'll start scoring extremely low. But just don't lose the time. I mean, like just don't lose hope. Okay, just keep on going and going. Just keep on, you know, fighting hard. Just keep on pushing. Okay. See, no one does a perfect 340 by 340 in the first test. Okay. I remember when I gave my first sample test, I scored somewhere like 290 or 291. Like, and for me, that was like, you know, if one cannot score above 320, you can't get into a good university. That's a total sham. That's something which is totally false. It depends on your holistic profile. So even if your GRE is low, you can compensate for that with your profile. But yeah, a high GRE score won't, it'll be very helpful for, you know, for a lot of things. For example, there are some universities which gonna offer you scholarships on the basis of your GRE percentiles. Okay, and for that case, getting a good GRE score will be an ace in the hat. But from me, the most important advice is just don't lose out on patience. Okay, it's a long marathon, so have some patience. Just keep struggling, keep fighting. If you don't know anything, ask anyone who knows it. Okay, and apart from that, you know, keep searching from solutions. Keep searching for more complex issues in the same problem. Okay. Just don't memorize the type of question. You know, just keep yourself flexible a bit. And that's it. And apart from that, keep increasing your reading speed. RCs, it'll help a lot in your RCs. Okay, and that's pretty much it. I don't know.
I think I like the way you said it. You know that it's not a 100-meter dash. You know, GRE preparation is a marathon. You know, and you will. The first few mock tests, you are going to do badly. You know, so tell yourself that you are going to do badly, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, because sitting for 3.5 hours and concentrating till the very last question is not a joke, you know.
Yeah.
So, and it is not a reflection of your capability also. It's just it's a test. That's it, you know. And a lot of things comes in the picture. Your stamina, your knowledge, your time management. So it's a lot of things. So if you get a poor score, it does not mean that you are a poor student. It just means that that day you didn't do well. That's it. So don't lose out hope. You know, stay patient. And as Rakshit is saying, it's a marathon. It's not a 100-meter dash. No.
Yeah.
Your stamina accordingly, right? So, Rakshit, which other colleges you are going to University of Maryland? But which other colleges did you get admission offers from?
I got admits from University of Minnesota, State University of New York, Buffalo, and University of Arizona, ASU. And these are the universities which I can recall. I applied to other, these are the universities which I got admission from.
So that's a quite an impressive list, you know. So with you know, again, given the fact that you do not have a 320 plus on your GRE score, so it again comes to I would like to reiterate that, you know, it's the, you have to work on your entire profile. You know, just having a GRE score is not enough. Versus like you have to have a good GRE score to get admission. Both of those situations are not, you know, like are extremes. They're not correct, you know.
Yeah. So one more thing which I would like to highlight is like, you know, you're also supposed to showcase your entire life, like showcase your entire academic journey as well as professional journey in your SOP as well. Suppose if one has, you know, extremely good, you know, Olympiads and, you know, good scores everywhere, but he or she is not able to showcase it in your SOP, then everything goes for a waste. You know, basically you are also supposed to showcase each and everything in a wonderful way to the university, because what they do is like, see, nobody has the time to read your entire SOP. So nobody goes through it entirely. But yeah, what they do is like, you know, they'll just get to know like, what are the most important points, and they'll just, you know, figure out like, how have you mentioned it? Okay. Because storytelling is something which is extremely important in the Western world. And by Western world, I mean like, you know, European countries and Australia and in the US as well. Storytelling is extremely important. That's what I've come to know. So apart from that, one should also be a good storyteller if you want to get into a really good college as well.
Right. So SOP is the SOP, the personal statement, your like entire application. No, they have to be in sync, basically. You know, they have to be impressive, right? Don't make silly mistakes like spelling errors, etc. So double check your entire application. These are the like, you know, basics, obviously. Right? So Lalit, which other schools you have you got admission from?
From Arizona State University and North Carolina State University. I submitted GRE in both of them.
Okay. And UCLA, right? You got three admits.
Yeah.
Okay. Good. Of course, UCLA was a no-brainer, right?
Yeah.
Right. Jinesh, how about you? Which colleges did you get admits from?
Yeah, I got admits from University of Irvine and Arizona State University.
So why did you pick Northeastern?
Yeah, so for the UCA course which I got into, so that was a kind of a, you know, professional oriented course. Like there were a lot of subjects, but most of them were with respect to professional course. And I had actually published 3 research papers. My interest is towards, you know, doing some research. So I had last year when I had gone to a conference in Canada, so I had met a lot of professors and I had a chat with a lot of professors from Northeastern University. So I was, you know, inclined to work with them on a lot. So that is the reason. Like I knew a lot of professors who are part of a lot of labs in Northeast University, and that is the reason like I chose to go over there instead of UCA.
Did you also apply for any funding, etc.?
No, I didn't apply anything from the Northeast University funding sites.
So Rakshit, this was probably very you know, a tough decision for you, you know, to, I mean, you are already earning, you are working, you have been working, so there may have been people who have told you like, you know, why give up the job and apply in a pandemic year, etc. So didn't you like hesitate, or you know, didn't you second guess yourself?
Yeah, actually a lot of people, you know, suggested me like, you know, instead of, you know, going over there, you can switch over here and you can switch to really good companies and things like that. But see what happened, like if you're keeping in my shoes, I actually got comfortable in my, you know, zone. Basically, I was working, I was earning a lot of money. So that's, you know, that's the case with every other IT guy. But what, you know, the difference which one makes in his or her life is, you know, stepping out of the comfort zone. What will happen, like once you start earning in India, okay, 1 to 2 years down the line, you'll get you'll get used to your work, you'll get used to the life you're living in. And apart from that, you'll be trapped in something which I call as your comfort bubble. Okay. In order to succeed in your life, what I think is that you know, one should always break out of their comfort bubble. You know, if you don't break out of your comfort bubble, you'll always stay in in particular, basically in just one area of your life. So if you just step out of your comfort zone, you'll have a lot of opportunities to explore. For example, suppose I'm working in XYZ company as an analyst. Okay, what's going to happen? 2 to 3 years down the line, I'll have a promotion, maybe one or two post higher. Okay, but suppose if I choose a further education, what's going to happen? I'm going to get extra knowledge. I'm going to have a really, really good network of really awesome people. And I'll be having a practical hands-on study, okay, which will be extremely in-depth. And a lot of other things, like, you know, I'll be in a good environment. I'll be in a, you know, I'll be in a very good place. So all in all, you know, the chance of going to a US university is actually the best thing which you can do to yourself. That's what I think. You know, it's gonna transform you. It'll evolve
investment,
you.
Investment in your future rather than short term gains. I think it's an investment into a long term.
100%. You can call it that. You can call it as an investment, and But the most important thing which I think is that it'll be a life changing experience for you overall. You know, if you're just moving out from here and going over there, see what's gonna happen. Like you'll have to struggle for a lot of things. Okay, over in India, like you have a lot of comforties at your home. Like a maid is gonna come and she or he's gonna clean your house, and there's a cook who's gonna come and cook food for you. But in the US, the things are totally different. The dimensions are totally different. You are supposed to do each and everything of your task. If you are supposed to run each and every code by yourself. So all in all, it'll be, you will evolve as a human being. You'll evolve as a person. You'll start seeing things from a different perspective. So that's what I think, which matters. Like these are some of the things.
That's really deep, that's really deep. Lalit, when you were looking for universities, the shortlisting is a very important phase, of course, applying to the right universities. You should not end up going to the wrong college. So when you were shortlisting universities, what were your criteria? What were you looking for?
So I applied to all computer science program, and I was targeting the top universities, the top 10, top 20. So I mostly to 5-6, I applied to 5-6 top universities, which were in the difficult categories, and then two moderate and two safe category universities. So it was a mix of them, but more of I applied to ambitious universities.
But you want two safe kind of options as well, right?
Yeah.
Rakshit, how about you? On what basis did you shortlist the universities that you applied to?
Mostly it was on the courses which I love to have. So I initially I just went on Google and just typed the best MSIS program in the world, just like every one of us did, like with respect to your program. So I got a list of universities. Okay, from that I selected which are universities have courses which would meet my requirement, which would meet my end. Okay. And after that, I also went through which all universities have the best research area in that particular field. And from that, I made a list, and I just segregated them in an ambitious, safe, and the moderate. And I applied to them.
Jinesh, I think in your case, the experience is a little different, right? You were pretty keen on Northeastern because you had interacted with professors, right?
Yeah, so I had applied to, the colleges which I had applied to, most of the professors, so I'd interact to a lot of, professors when I had gone to a conference last year in Canada. So I'd interact to around 17 to 18 professors, and the majority of the professors were the ones which I interacted to are from Northeastern. So I was able to easily, bond up with a lot of them, and I knew a lot of them once I was, done with my 6-day conference. So it was quite easy for me. So I had applied to all the universities. So I knew a lot of professors in UCI as well, but nothing concrete, which I felt was I knew one professor, but not on that level as I knew two or three professors in the Northeastern University. For me, that's why once I got into that particular program, I was quite confident that I'm going to go for that university this year, because I knew a lot of professors, and for my research grow path, this would be a good opportunity for me.
So I think, you know, I think let's open up the floor for Q&A. So anybody, if you have a question for any of our panelists, you know, please raise your hands. I will then give you mic access and then you can ask your questions. And before that, you know, do let us know for whom you have the questions so that, you know, that person can answer your question. All right. So Muhammad Shaheen, what's your question and who is it for?
Hello. Hello. Can
yes,
you
we
hear?
Can hear you. Yes,
audible
can
now?
Hear. Yeah, yeah, yes.
Okay, okay. I want to know about the any fees or it is a free course?
Repeat again?
It is a free course or any fees you...
Which course?
What?
I didn't... Of which course are you talking about?
That data science.
It cannot be a free course, obviously. All the universities, they have their own fees, etc.
How much the amount?
It will vary from university to university. So it can range anything between, you know, 20 to 50 lakhs. Yes, Akanksha, what's your question?
Ma'am, I just wanted to ask, are there any specific requirements for scholarship?
For scholarships, you know, you have to, having a strong research profile helps a lot. And then your academics and GRE score, but yeah, the maximum weightage is given to your, you know, your research profile.
So ma'am, just one more thing, like I'm doing my graduation right now. And so I'm working on the research part as well. I'm writing research papers. So like how many one must write to secure a scholarship?
There's no such cutoff. It also depends on the quality as well, where you are getting them published, international journals versus national journals. You know, they are still better than just conference proceedings. So where you are getting them published also, you know, matter a lot. And it will depend on which college, the top college, like, you know, which, where getting admission itself is difficult, you know, there, you know, it may be even more difficult to get scholarships, right? So which college you are applying to? Usually, if they're willing to compromise on the quality of college a little bit, then their chances of getting scholarship increase.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Adarsh Tiwari, what's your question and who is it for?
Hello.
Yeah, hi.
I'm available. Yeah, my question is to the person who got selected in the University of California. I want to ask him then what he did to make his profile better. Is something special about his research, yeah, where he got chance to get his research?
Yes, Lalit.
Yeah, so I started exploring my area of interest in my second year. In my second year, I realized that I want to pursue my research in machine learning. So when I got in, started my third year, I started writing a research paper with my college professor. After that, I had some experience. Then I got a research intern at IIT Hyderabad. So that helped a lot. And most of my papers were, I was the primary author. So this was the main thing. Like, you can show the capability of performing independent research and you can ask your professors to write that you are so a potential candidate. And I also got a LOR from IIT. He was an associate professor. So that also mattered a lot because I'm not from IIT. So getting a LOR from IIT and doing a research at IIT, that was something one should do if you are not from a tier one college.
Thanks, Lalit.
And, yeah.
No, please continue.
Yeah, so, and also you should not publish the paper just for the sake of publication, like you are publishing in just conference and low level conferences. You can start by publishing a paper if you want some research experience. So I published in an international journal and an international conference, both for Scopus Index, and I also got a patent which has like 5 to 6 times more value than a research paper. So you can do like publish in top journals. That will help a lot, even if you have a paper, if you have one paper, instead of having 4 papers in conference.
Yeah, I agree. You know, just if you can manage to get one international, you know, journal publication, that is far better than having 3-4 conference proceedings, you know. All right, Ishan, what's your question? Yes, Ishan.
So, what's your question? Am I audible?
Yes, we can hear you.
Hi, good evening, Aryama Madam and Lalit, Jinesh and Rakshit. I'm Ishan. I'm from Noida. You know, I already have a master's degree in business administration, and I want to pursue a PhD in marketing, preferably from US and Canada. I will be applying to both the countries. As of now, along with my friend, I have started skimming through GRE exam, as I want to take it sometime in November or December. But a few people have also suggested me to look out for GMAT because it is much more focused for applying through the management education part. I have been a non-engineer. I have done my BCom and then MBA. And then I have been working since past 3-4 years, right? So what shall be the right track, GMAT or GRE, and how much preparation should I take to, you know, before taking the exam this year?
So first of all, you know, for PhD in Canada, you don't need anything. You know, you need a research proposal. For outside US or in all countries, the maximum weightage is given to your research proposal. You should have a topic and a proposal, and so that's the biggest requirement. In the US, between, you know, GMAT and GRE, so for PhD, you know, they have equal weightage. So it's not true that for management you have to have GMAT. No, that's not true. So for PhD programs, so you should take an exam where you can score high, right? So I would recommend that you take a mock test or something of GRE and one for GMAT, and then decide which one you are more comfortable with, right? And then take that. Pick an exam where you have higher chances of getting a good score. Okay, that's. So
just a small question. I have also heard about this, you know, PhD we all have heard about. There is also a DBA, Doctoral in Business Administration. So how is that different from a PhD?
So DBA is like you need a business academics, as you need to have a business profile only, you know, BCom plus in the whole, you need to have a hardcore business profile only. The PhD is more generic, anybody can do. Not anybody means, and obviously, but it is not like DBA is equivalent to an MD, so to say, you know, in the sense that you have to have that background. Your bachelor's degree, your work, everything has to be in business administration.
Okay, so suppose I already have a MBA, Master's in Business Administration. It's from one of the government universities, UP Technical Universities. So if I want to apply for a PhD in marketing versus a DBA, should I apply
for PhD in marketing? PhD
in marketing.
Okay. Not DBA, you can take, as I said, so for your MBA, you did your MBA, so did you take the CAT?
Yes, I had the CAT.
Yeah, so the CAT, if you have taken the CAT, then GMAT is very similar to CAT. So maybe you will do better in GMAT, but yeah, do take a mock test of GRE and a mock test of GMAT and then decide.
Sure.
All right.
Okay, thank you.
No, thanks. Suryakant Kashyap, what's your question?
Hello. Yes. My question is to everyone, anyone who can address this better. My question is, did you get TA or RSIP? Did you apply for it?
So did any of you apply? Rakshit, Jinesh and Lalit?
Yeah, I'll go first. So for me, I think in my program, they don't give RA, so they don't have RA or T options in the first semester. But I inquired and asked a lot of seniors. I already asked upon, and they have told me that there are opportunities available for RA and TA probably from the second semester. And like, so for the first semester, either you need to build a good rapport with your professor. So that is when they ask you to do a lot of voluntary work. And once, you have a good rapport and they identify the work which you're doing is quite valuable, that is when, at least for my university, they allow you to do those options, like to get those opportunities.
Okay. So did you try contacting any professor before going?
Yeah, so there are for TA jobs actually in my university, they have a portal. So basically the main the qualification, or you can say like a prerequisite which they ask for a TA, is to have good grades into those subjects which you want to do TA for, or probably the prerequisite subjects for those particular subjects which you have scored good in. So that is something which they look on to, the professors. Like, if, for example, for my case, because I knew a lot of professors, so the communication was quite easier. But if, for example, if you don't know anyone when you're going, so the best way is to get a good, academic score in the subjects which, you want to do RAOT and whichever professor you want to pursue onto. Like, you may have to build a good rapport, and over time, probably in second semester or probably in your third semester, they might give you those research opportunities. So that is how it works, at least for our university.
Okay.
How about you, Lalit?
So I can apply for both RA and TA in the first quarter, but the applications will open in August. And for RA, the professor said when you come here, you can contact us. So that is it. In August, I'll apply for TA.
How did you apply it? Like, is there a separate portal for it?
The process that for RA you need to contact professors, and for TA it is offered by the department, so they give you the forms and there is a portal like for TA
after you get admission. So TA after, you can apply after you get an admission from that university.
And if you get TA and RA, so 50% of your 25-50% of your fees is reduced.
Get to pay in state then. Yeah. How about you, Rakshit? Did you apply for any RA/TA yet?
No, actually, even for my university, the RA and TA portion shall be, starting from the orientation week, which starts from 23rd of August. Okay. So for that, what happens, there's a procedure on which we have to go on a portal. For our university, the name of that portal is eJobs. Okay. For their and over there, you're supposed to upload your resume and why do you want to go for this RA or TA job or GRA, which is called as graduate research assistant job. Okay. And after that, you'll probably get a call, basically a Skype meeting call or a Zoom meeting call from the professors who are, who have initiated this position. Okay. And you have to give an interview. And if you're good enough, then you'll be selected, and a fee remission is also given. That's fee remission is 25-50% in UMD as well. Apart from that, what I did, I received a scholarship of $10,000 while applying. Okay, in my admit letter, I got the scholarship. So that is one other thing which really persuaded me to go to this university as well.
Oh, okay, that's good. All right. Ritvik Jindal, what's your question?
Good evening, ma'am, and good evening to all the panelists. So ma'am, my question is, my BTEC is in IT branch. In many of the universities, can I apply in the computer science program? Because I was researching for San Jose University. So in that university, I can't apply for the computer science program. I have to go for software engineering program. So is there the case with the other universities as well?
So what exactly is your bachelor's degree in?
Ma'am, information technology.
Okay. See, computer science happens to be the most competitive field. A lot of students from India apply there. So you have a bachelor's in IT, and do you have computer science work experience?
No, my bachelor's will end next year in 2022.
So in a lot of the universities, they will ask you to apply for a master's in software engineering or, you know, maybe MIS, not the hardcore computer science. So you have to like go through each university's requirements, you know, or prerequisites carefully. There will be some universities we have applied for students in some universities, but yeah, you know, you have to look, go through each university's eligibility criteria. There will be universities, but not a lot of them, you know.
Okay. And ma'am, any like any news about the 2022 waiver, GRE waiver as of now?
Some universities are saying that they will not waiver, that's optional, you know. So okay. It's up to you. So there's a difference between waiver and optional. You know, waiver okay. means they were not going to look at anybody's GRE score. So that's okay. not the case. Right? So optional means it's up to you whether you submit your GRE score or not. So if okay. you get a very high GRE score, you should then submit. If you don't, then if you don't get a good GRE score, then don't submit. So there are some universities which have waived the GRE requirement for 2022 also. So you can check those out, you know. Google is the best place to start off with.
Yeah, yeah.
You can have a word with your admissions counselor also. Are you a Jamboree student?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, then you can ask your admissions counselor as well.
Okay. So ma'am, I have another question. Yeah. Yeah, but my question is to Mr. Rakshit.
Good
evening, sir. So, sir, like you applied in the MIS program, right?
Yeah, information systems. Not yeah, technically MIS. MIS, but yeah.
Information system. Yeah, yeah. So, sir, like your like work profile is also somewhat related to the like data science part.
Yeah, yeah, it's actually a bit related to data science part.
So, sir, have you researched, like, I think you must have talked to your seniors over there, like, what are the job prospects? Like, I also talked to, like, some of the people who are currently pursuing their master's. So, I got some feedback, like, the job prospects for the, doing after the MIS for the, data science people are a bit less as compared to the computer science grads.
No, I don't think that it's true because, see, data science is not computer science entirely. Definitely, yeah, you are true about this fact that in technical terms, the CS folks will definitely have an edge over any normal person, okay? Suppose if you are from management field, right? But data science just not involves CS. It also involves something which is called as domain knowledge. Okay. Let's say if a person has an BTech or MTech in biotechnology, he or she must be having some great deal of knowledge in biotechnology or let's say something as genetic therapy or genome sequencing, right. Anything like that. Okay. Right. So a normal CS guy won't be having this much of domain knowledge, right?
Yeah, correct.
And let's say if this biotech guy gets some sort of coding knowledge and some basic level of statistical knowledge, he or she will be a better data scientist as compared to a normal CS grad.
Yeah.
So basically data science is not just one particular field. It's kind of an amalgamation of different fields, which includes maths, which includes domain knowledge, coding as well. Coding is also important. I'm not shedding off. It's important. It's really important. But yeah, there is no such hardcore or hard defined rules that, CS guy will be having a better salary. I know a lot of people who don't know how to code properly. They just knew bits and pieces. They basically just knew elementary level of coding, but they have grabbed packages of like 140, 150K in San Francisco Bay Area.
Okay. Great. So thank you. You cleared my doubt. I was very much confused between what to choose. Like I'll be filling the applications in September or October. I have my GRE next month. So I'm a bit confused about the MIS and the CS program. Also, sir, is it mandatory? Like if we have research papers, for example, for the graduate requirements, there are two options. Like the option A, it is research or thesis based, and option B, it is project based. Am I right?
No, for my university, I don't think that there's this kind of any option.
That's not a blanket rule, Ritvik. So yeah. Some universities have a thesis masters and non-thesis masters option, but this is just but a lot of universities, they don't give you the option. You know, it is you have to do the thesis. You know, it's a part of the mandatory part of the master's program.
Okay. Right, ma'am. Right. So thank you so much.
It's more a UK thing. In UK universities, there are two types of masters: research masters or taught masters. So, okay. But in the US, it's either in a few universities, you'll find the thesis masters versus non-thesis masters options. But you should always go for a thesis master's option because that has the higher credibility. Plus, if you ever want to get any, if you ever want to be considered for any kind of RAP, etc., then the thesis master's kids, they get not in on thesis master's ones.
Oh, okay, ma'am. Right. Thank you so much.
The thesis and non-thesis thing is also predominant in Canada as well, because one of my friend was applying to Canadian universities and she also had this same option. Like, she was also confused in this.
But there again, everywhere, you know, thesis masters are a better, are like, you know, more esteemed option than the non-thesis option, you know?
Okay.
All right, so last question of the day. So we go to Rushi Shah. So Rushi Shah, you can unmute yourself. So it's the last question of the day. For the rest of you, if we could not take your questions, you know, you can post your questions in the chat along with your numbers where we can reach you. We'll our team will get in touch with you to address your questions. Yes, Rushi, please go on.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. So good evening, everyone. My question is for Rakshit. I'm sorry. So I was actually planning to go for Fall 22. And I was actually confused between MIS and business analytics, as you two were. So could you like give me more insights as to how did you clear that confusion?
Yeah, that's a really good question. Okay, so what you're supposed to do is check out their curriculum. Okay, because I remember like when I was applying to University of Southern California. Okay, so there was this two option. The one was MIS or IS, and the other one was business analytics. But when I went through their course, I got to know, like, you know, business and sticking to business analytics and applying to BA, like MSBA, would be a better option for me as compared to applying to information systems over there. So, you know, there's this gray line between business analytics and MIS. Okay, in some universities, basically, things differ. In some universities, the MSBA course is better, and in some universities the MSIS course or MSMIS course is better. Okay, it basically depends on what you want, what kind of courses you want to pursue. So, you know, please be sure to check out each and every courses, you know, if possible, then go in depth of like for each and every course they'll be you know, giving a brief info about it. So please carefully go through that. This is an extremely just don't apply to the courses by their name. Okay, because when I was searching for university, so I came through the program of Purdue's university, Purdue's MSMIS, but Purdue's MIS was heavily leaned on managerial stuff, and almost like one or two courses only were technical. So for me, that wasn't a good choice, and I didn't apply to Purdue. So
One easy check is that if you have an MSIS or MIS program that is offered by the business school, then it is going to be heavy management and less technical, you know. So you just, that can be one easy, so there will not be too much data science in it, more business analytics in it, kind of thing, right? So that's one way you can check, and do go to the curriculum in detail as well.
I just wanted to ask if it is possible, if Rakshit could share his LinkedIn or something, if in future, because I think we have quite similar profiles currently. So if I have any doubts, and he's open to helping out.
Yeah, sure. I'll post it in the comments, and you know, you can just, you know, ping me up over there.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Yeah, it's totally fine. Thank you.
So, Lalit, you know, any parting advice to students? They will be in the same situation as you guys, you know, 1 year from now, hopefully. So, any parting advice?
So, I can just say you should start early in first or second year of the college. And one advice on GRE, I can tell what not to do, because in verbal I couldn't score good. So after you go through the GRE, and after that you give a mock test. I didn't give a mock test just before 15 days of my exam. Like, at that time I gave the mock test, so I came to know that my verbal is so weak. So once you start preparing, or you go through the GRE syllabus and everything, you give the mock, and then you get to know that like how much preparation do you need for that verbal? Some of you might take 2 months and some of you might take a year. So you can keep this in mind.
Thanks, Lalit. Jinesh, any parting advice from you?
Nothing specific. So I would like to say that you focus on your complete application, because like as you are preparing for your JRE, it's not something that like once you do with your JRE, you are like done with the process. You have a lot of stuff which is pulled up later on. You have your LORs, your SOPs to be prepared upon. So I think for most of the colleges, like, and I think some of you guys were asking for scholarship as well. So I think a lot of them have like, early deadlines for scholarship as well. So try to apply as early as possible. And for that, I think it's better to get your GRE and your TOEFL exams done as soon as possible so that you can focus more on your LOR, SOPs, because, it is an iterative process. Like once you write out everything, it will take a lot of time to go through all of them again and again, because you need to refine and make it one of your best versions of yourself. So that, and also for LORs, you need to contact your professors or your business partners if you are using your experience as your recommendation. So I would tell everyone to start as early as possible, because the process and the journey is quite long. So you'll need a lot of time to probably do a research or probably prepare other parts of your application. So yeah, I think just do start quickly as much as possible.
Right, the GRE or GMAT, that's just the tip of the iceberg. The work actually starts after that. So a lot of work, in fact. Right. So Rakshit, any parting advice?
What I said earlier, have some patience. Okay, it's gonna be a step-by-step process. Okay, but yeah, at each and every step, try to give your best. Okay, and just don't lose out on hope. Okay, hope is actually a very good thing. And one of the most important thing is that while applying to any university, they won't just check your GRE or TOEFL or just one or two things. They'll assess you on your entire profile. So, work on strengthening your profile. Okay, work on, if someone is interested in data science and pursuing MS in data science or, MS in information systems, which is heavily focused on data science, then I can advise is that create a Kaggle profile. Kaggle and GitHub are something which would speak for themselves. Okay, so have a really good Kaggle profile. Apart from that, yeah, I would like to agree with what Jinesh said. Focus on SOP and LOR, try to make the best SOP and LOR of your life. And just your SOP should be something unique about yourself. How do you see the world? How do you see this course? What are you like, on what perspective do you assess things? Okay, and things like that. So basically make a questionnaire out of yourself. Okay, ask yourself these questions and fill in the answers. Okay, and then you can club things up and make a very good SOP, which is truly original to yourself.
When you get down to writing your SOPs, please do not, get templates from the internet. Yeah. So they are not going to be unique. SOP is not supposed to be a template. So please do not copy paste stuff from the internet. You may end up getting rejected for plagiarism, right? So I get a lot of students who come to me with like templates of SOPs downloaded from XYZ websites and all. So don't do that. Try to, you may think your English is bad, but it's still your voice should be there, your story should be there, right? Don't just use fancy adjectives. It should be your story, right? That is very important. Okay, so Rakshit, Jinesh and Lalit, thank you so much. It has been such an, enlightening experience, really lively discussions. Thank you so much for doing this for us. We have worked, you guys have worked with Jamboree, but still, I think it is a really privilege. We are privileged to have students like you who give us, their time even after you have gotten admission. So thank you so much.
Thank you for inviting.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot for the invitation.
All the best. Do well. Stay in touch.
Sure. Yeah, sure.
And take care. Thanks, everyone.
Yeah, thank you, guys.
Thanks a lot, everyone.
Thank you, everyone. Bye.